Hello, and welcome to the American Songbook Association's Sunday Session Series. This series is an ongoing fundraiser for our expanding education programs. The American Songbook Association reaches thousands of students nationwide, teaching jazz, musical theater, and the great American songbook in an effort to preserve and promote these timeless American musical legacies. This programming also includes Cabaret Scenes magazine, the official magazine of the ASA, devoted to covering live music in the United States and Europe. We hope that you enjoy each episode of this Sunday Session series. We ask that you subscribe to our YouTube channel and that you consider a donation. Every dollar helps us keep the music playing. See the banner at the bottom of your screen for details. Thank you. And now, here is your Sunday Session series host, Carolyn Montgomery.
And if you can say Sunday Session Series three times very, very fast, you get a prize at the end of this show. I am Carolyn Montgomery, and I'm thrilled to be back here for a Sunday Sessions Series production. We started these as a way to keep in touch with our favorite artists during the pandemic lockdown. And in a wonderful stroke of luck, well, we were able to keep them going. People really are enjoying them, and it's a way to get a casual and intimate look at some of your favorite performers, and I'm especially excited about today. You've seen her in many, many Broadway productions on cabaret stages across the nation and in Europe. She has won an Outer Critics Theater Award. She has won 3 Bistro Awards. She's won a Nightlife Award, and she has won 458,000 Mac Awards. This is Karen Mason.
I would, wow, for that, that's even more than I can imagine.
I was reading, I was just sort of going over some information, and I thought, oh my God.
Well, I was at the first one, so, you know.
Yeah, that is something. You know something else? We won a Nightlife Award in the same year. We were at Town Hall in the same, you won major, I was minor or whatever, just female vocalist, but it was a terrific night. That was a great night.
Yeah, listen, it's always nice to have somebody, you know, tell you that you're doing a good job.
See, exactly. And that's how, you just made my job easier. one of the things in researching Karen was that I asked several people that have worked with her about her, and more than 3 of them, so 4 of them actually, but that's a lot, that's a lot. Said, many wonderful things, but among them, she makes it look easy. And I thought about that. I know. I thought about that. And so I usually have an overarching theme for each of these interviews that just works its way in as we speak. But I want to talk about how hard it is to make it look easy, right? So let's start at the beginning. And also, the first question I ask everybody is, how did you survive the pandemic? What did you do during that time?
Well, I got bored very quickly because we were in lockdown, you know, like everybody else. And my husband worked straight through it. He's a record producer and could sit in the office and work. So right. He would wake up, go in there, and I'd walk from room to room and bounce off walls and go, what
an
audience. Yeah. So I saw the direction that a lot of acting was going for auditions, and thought, you know, this would be a good time for me to learn how to do self-tape. So mm-hmm. I started, SAG-AFTRA had a couple of classes online, and I thought, okay, well, you know, I might be able to do that. I have some of the equipment, you know, Paul says all these things from Amazon kept arriving, which were lights and microphones and stuff. Yeah. Backdrops, but I learned how to do it. And I thought, okay, maybe why not try to do a little something, a little show. And every Thursday I started with 3 songs, and I ended up doing a half an hour every Thursday for about a year, you know, and
I saw some of them. They were terrific.
Well, I got better at them.
Right. As one does, you know,
it's, yeah. But it was an interesting journey, you know, to learn how to get better at something. You know, I'm not a spring chicken. And so to It actually always frustrates me when I hear people my age go, well, I just don't know how to operate my phone. It's like,
yeah,
are you kidding me? You know, it's a machine. Learn how to use it.
That's right. I mean, occasionally I will ask my 18-year-old son, because I know that I'm going to spend 4 hours trying to figure out how to dim the light on my phone. I'll figure it out if he's not here, and he's in college now, so I can't be in touch with him that often. But he just picks it up, and he has sort of an innate way of touching a screen that I didn't grow up with.
Oh, right.
So he knows how to tap, drag, bit, 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 bop. And I'm like, how did you do? Could you slow down and just let me see, you know, because they do have a way of thinking. But I agree with you. And think about what this pandemic would have been if we didn't have technology.
I can't even comprehend what it would have been like. And we got a chance to spend time on Zoom with friends.
Exactly. You know,
my family, I got to see my family in Chicago, and I have a niece in Australia.
Yes, and exactly. And one of the things too is, I was going to say about you, is I was just so glad to be able to have an hour where she can sit down, you know, because you're so busy. And so it did make us all slow down a little bit.
Yeah, that was really kind of good. That was good. It was a time in my life where I wasn't traveling all of the time. And it was, I have to say, you know, in a kind of a weird way, I enjoyed the lockdown.
I think a lot of people are admitting that there were aspects to slowing down that made us focus on what was important. And, you know, that's, if you haven't seen it, please go look at Michael Holland's song, Wait, that he wrote during the pandemic. It is breathtakingly perfect.
Oh, great. Yeah, I'm writing it down now.
Yeah, you'll really love it. Yeah. All right. So let's start at the very beginning, a very good place to start. Where are you from?
I was born in New Orleans.
All right.
And both my parents are Southern.
Okay.
They grew up right down the street from each other, but never really knew each other. They knew of each other, but never really knew each other. And then when they met, my dad, you know, my mom was swooning over my dad.
Yeah.
And they got married, and we stayed down there. I have an older sister. I have a younger sister. So I'm that, you know, fantastic middle child. There you go. There's that group of smiling folk.
Yes.
And do we not all have my mother's smile? I mean,
single one of you, look at that. That is just amazing. Yeah. Sister.
So I had, my older sister was born and my dad got transferred. So we started moving north. Okay. And we were in mostly St. Louis and Chicago. That was kind of where I considered my hometown was Chicago.
That's what I thought so, because I remember when you go to Chicago, a lot of people will say, she's coming home. She's, you know, she's coming home to Chicago. And I'm like, she lives in New York. We own her.
I've been here 40 something years now.
Yeah, you're a New Yorker. I would say you're a New Yorker. So anybody else in your family musical?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, both my sisters sing.
Yeah.
My younger sister has the remarkable voice, but she did not like the business and didn't like any aspect of it. So she was singing for a long time. She likes the tight harmony, madrigal stuff.
This is weird. I mean, I have three sisters and we used to sing in all in harmony. We all sang different parts. Yeah. And they just, it's the best.
It is the best. Right. When we sang, actually, we sang at my older sister's wedding, Paul, Kim, and myself. And it was so much fun. I mean, our voices blend so beautifully. And now my older sister is working on her voice and singing in choirs. And the three of us together, it's remarkable how our voices, like you say, they just blend in a way that three strangers don't.
Exactly, because you're aspects of each other. That's what my mother used to say. My mother had a beautiful voice as well.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yeah, she sang beautifully. And so she loved it when we did, and we were encouraged and offered lessons. Did you take any music lessons when you were a little person?
Not when I was a little person. My mom did not have a voice. My dad had a mellifluous speaking voice, but no sense of pitch.
Yeah.
and couldn't stay, you know, he would sing and he would be in all kinds of keys.
Right. So what brought you to music? What made you?
Well, it turns out, I mean, I always loved singing. We always had music around. My mom was a pianist. Mm-hmm. And they played music all the time. My mother played the piano. She sent us all in for piano lessons. It turns out that her mother, who she did not know, her mother, it was a sad story, but her mother deserted her when she was a baby.
Wow.
Because her mom wanted a career. And she was a beautiful woman who was a singer in a band. In my grandfather's band, and she wanted a career, and so she took off. She could not handle having a baby. Yeah. So my mother was raised by her grandmother and her dad and her great aunt. And so I, at one point, my great aunt, whose name was Miriam, but we called her Mamie, mm-hmm. Mamie told me that I sounded exactly like Juanita, who was my mom's mom.
Wow.
Yeah.
And wow, that is quite a story.
Yeah. That, isn't it amazing?
There's a musical in there. Somebody needs to write it. Listen, one of the things that I was going to do was to play you on, and I was so excited to get you on into the studio with me. I didn't do it. And I'd like to do it now, because if I get to watch Karen Mason sing Miss Baltimore Crabs as Velma von Hussel, it gives me life. But we've got a little video montage of three of the roles that Karen has played on Broadway.
And my subtle acting.
And it's just, I watched it like three times and thought, I can't get enough of this. Karen Mason.
Well, I'm not over 45, so if you just put them on, I'll show you my stuff. Haven't you already shown us enough?
Oh my God, how times have changed. This girl's either blind or completely deranged. How the times seem to halt. But I was Miss Baltimore Crabs.
It's always been my childhood dream to dance on this show.
Well, maybe you ought to go back to sleep.
I love the dreams. Me were cracked when that damn Shirley Temple stole my freaking act. But the crabs in the bowl from when I was Miss Baltimore Crabs. Those poor runner-ups might still hold some grudges they had in their cups. But I screwed the judge with the claws of they win. They're a play.
you're just joining us, I'm Carolyn Montgomery, the Executive Director of the American Songbook Association. And my guest today on the Sunday Session series is Broadway and cabaret phenom Karen Mason. Oh, I had to play those. I just loved it so much. You looked like you were having the time of your life.
Oh, you know, there's nothing better than being on stage on a broad, especially a Broadway stage.
Yeah.
With an orchestra.
Yeah, I know. And you've played very, very eclectic roles. You've played a lot of different.
None of them very subtle, though, as we look
at. There may be a reason for that, darling. There's loads of personality, oozing personality. So how'd you get there? How did you get to, where did you go in high school, for instance? Were you doing leads in your productions, musical productions?
Well, it started out, I went to an all-girls Catholic high school, so we kind of did, the nuns would let us do very literate things. So we did Alice in Wonderland and stuff like that. And I auditioned for that and got cast. And, but then the boys' school did the musicals. And in reality, I was looking for a date.
Yeah.
And because you have to get your own date when you go to an all-girls
school. I went to an all-girls school, too.
There, so yeah. So you know here. From whence I speak.
You join clubs that partner with the boys' schools. That's what you do.
Yeah, I mean, they always make it very complicated. And so I went to, it was called St. Viator's, and auditioned. And there was no turning back from that very moment, the second I was on that stage. I mean, I always sung and, you know, did these other little things. But being in a musical, man, I tell you, Carolyn, it was as soon as I was on that stage, and the first role I got was just a townsperson in Annie, Get Your Gun. I had one line. And in reality, the guy who was the director, we became good friends. He came up to me during rehearsals and said, you know, you need to speak up. You're just not loud enough. Mm-hmm. And well, you know, the rest
is... That is word, Karen. I think, we've been talking, I was talking to a friend about people would refer to you, I think, as a Broadway belter because you can, and you have a big, beautiful voice. What is a Broadway belter? It's a person who can sustain a very loud vibrato-free note for a long period of time, but just because you can doesn't mean you have to. And no. I don't feel that you use that belt more than you should, but certainly, you know, you're known for having this massive voice, and it's a beautiful thing to see.
Well, thank you. You know, as I've gotten older, I've really enjoyed not doing as much belting.
Yep.
And I enjoy doing those quiet songs, or really just saving it for certain places. Yeah. But you do get pigeonholed into that, you know, because if you can, you get cast as that.
That's right. Because it's sort of a feat of daring do, you know, but I walk into Don't Tell Mama on any given evening on my way to a show, and I hear some young thing, you know, coughing up a lung, singing a song. And I think, oh, sweetie, save something for the mystery, you know?
Yeah, right.
You don't need to be doing this, you know? Hard to learn. So did you go to college? Did you study music in college?
I did. I did not do that. Uh-huh. I went to the University of Illinois at Chicago Circle. Uh-huh. And it was very much a science and engineering school.
Right.
They had a music department, but it was mostly opera. And I didn't want to do that. I was a musical theater doll. And so I'd studied a little acting in college, but in reality, I just screwed it up. I wasn't totally interested in it, and just wanted to be wearing pretty outfits and singing.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I wasted a lot of time and money and energy not telling my parents that I wasn't really doing a great job. So I left college after too many years and, you know, started doing a lot of community theater and just surviving, doing survival jobs in Chicago. And then in March of 1976, which I know is a long time ago, I went and auditioned at a place in Chicago called, it was a restaurant that had singing waiters and waitresses. A place called Lawrence of Oregano's. It no longer exists.
That's hilarious.
They had the best titles of restaurants. It was, let us entertain you. Amazing. But they were hiring singing waiters and waitresses. And my sister, as a matter of fact, gave me, and I found it the other day, gave me the placard that she ripped off the bathroom wall that said, if you're interested in, you know, singing, being a singing waiter, call this number. So she gave it to me and I called and went and sang. And the Michael J., who was the manager at the time, said, oh, we'd love to have you here. I get a phone call the next day that I had to come back and re-audition for the gentleman who is the music director.
Okay.
And I went back in, and it was Brian Lasser, who I worked with for 6 years.
Oh, that's how you guys, that's how you met.
Yeah, so Brian was so instrumental, Carolyn, in turning my life around, in giving me, I guess I'm better being a partner than I am necessarily being on my own to do things, although I've had to learn how to do that, but I'm a much better collaborator.
Yes.
And
a lot of people are. It's a working style.
Yeah.
You know, having somebody else's opinion besides your own, having other eyes to look at it and ears to hear it.
And sharing that. You know, I love to share I love to be in a room with somebody and you create something together.
I agree. I think music is to be shared. And I think that's what makes, you know, a lot of performers get pegged as people that just want attention. That's not it. I really think it's about having something you want to say, practicing it, learning it, and conveying it.
Oh, yeah.
And the audience gets it and you get something back. That's a collaboration too. But I know exactly what you mean. So you ended up working at this restaurant?
For about three to six months. It was Brian. They decided they didn't want to pay Brian anymore because he was, you know, he was bringing in a bass and a drums. Yeah. He was trying to up it. And he was doing arrangements for like 8 to 10 singers.
Yeah.
And he and I just started, you know, you're supposed to do 2 hours a week. Well, he and I started doing 2, 4, 6, 8. And I think they just saw the writing on the wall and didn't want to pay for it anymore. And when he left, I left.
Yeah.
I didn't.
And then where did you go?
I just basically started doing little like private events in homes that he was hired for.
Yeah.
He would be hired to play piano. And he said, could I bring along a singer? And they said, yes, but we can't give you any more money. So, but we were so, it sounds weird, but so in love with performing with each other.
Yeah.
That
doesn't sound weird at all.
That, you know, he was willing to split with me. And so we kind of were starting to develop a name for ourselves. We worked at a place called The Pub. It was a gay bar that had a back area, which was a little bit more of a restaurant bar. The front was just the bar, and then the back had a piano and they'd do performances. And Brian was playing for somebody else and said, could I bring somebody over to audition for you? And we auditioned for, his name was Danny Riley, who owned it. And he became like my big brother, guardian angel. And we started doing one night a week. And then we started doing their big night, half price nights. And from that, we started adding 2, 3, 4, 5 days a week, doing maybe 1 or 2. And then we were up to 5 days a week, 3 shows a night.
Wow. Wow.
It's a lot of work.
That is a lot of work. I was just about to, as I was saying this, you're like, no, I sort of drifted out of that and then drifted. I thought, oh my God, she does make it look easy. She's going to make it look easy and prove me wrong.
No, there are many scars along the way.
Well, and it sounds to me like it was just all practical experience. There's nothing like getting up in front of a different group of people and singing.
Absolutely.
It is the best thing. Just before the pandemic hit, I was singing every week at a hotel. And I would go up brand new group of people. And the best thing in the world is, you know, you realize that you really have something if they all come and sit down and put money in your tip jar and love you.
Right.
You know,
it's absolutely. And you learn the skills you learn by having different audiences. No audience is the same.
Yeah.
And how you, what you learn about what you can do to not manipulate, but kind of gauge and then change what you're doing just
absolutely.
A little bit.
That's right.
You know, it's like a first date. It's a continual first date.
That's right. And it teaches you a tremendous amount of humility and to keep your ears and your heart open to suggestions that other people are giving you. Here.
Right. And, you know, the interesting thing about cabaret is when people say, you know, it's just about getting attention. The thing is, it's again, another collaboration. It's the audience, your accompanist, and you.
That's
and
right.
How do you make this evening special for everybody?
Yeah. And, you know, I do want to touch on something because the Brian Lasser, Karen Mason duo makes me think of Wally Harper and Barbara Cook, who have said about each other. I mean, they changed each other's lives.
Yeah.
They were in love with each other in a very different kind of a way. You know, it was, I just need to make music with you. I love collaborating with you. There is a bond here that weaves a personal and artistic feeling completely together, like a tapestry. And it is very, very real. It's just a very different kind of a relationship. And I think it's rare. And I didn't realize how far back you went with Brian. So when did you get to New York?
We moved to New York. We had our first, we had gone about as far as we could go in Chicago. We were doing big concerts and filling them, you know, packing them at a place called Park West there, which I think seated, you know, like 500 people. So we were doing really well. And both of us, we said we can either go to Los Angeles or New York, but both of us had theatrical backgrounds. And New York was kind of the obvious.
Next to the cosmos,
Listen, we had a lot of people come to see us. And we, you know, people who could have made our careers really take off in a way. But, you know, we were very, I'm not exactly sure why it never happened that way. But, you know, I was kind of in that, I'm not really Barbara Streisand because I have a bigger voice than she does, but I certainly stole a lot from her. You know, I was incorporating from so many people what I loved about their singing, you know, between Garland and Streisand. It was like taking in everything I loved. And, you know, so we saw a lot of people, but it was left up to us to push our career. And so we both decided to move to New York in 1970. 78 is when we had our first job in New York at a club called The Ballroom.
Okay.
When it was downtown in Soho.
Yeah.
And then we moved here full time in 79.
Yeah. And how did you begin auditioning? Did you get yourself an agent? What brought you to the Broadway stage?
We were never that bright about our careers.
Okay.
We were just kind of two wacky kids who would go where the wind was blowing, you know?
Yeah.
And we loved, I mean, it is that. We always said that, and that, you know, that the music for us was kind of like, I know you have a younger audience, but
No, that's okay. It's all right. Yeah.
It was kind of like sex for us. Our music was our sex.
Yeah.
We were so, so close, so tight, such good friends, so married in so many ways. But he was gay and I was straight. So never the twain shall meet except in music.
Right.
And when we moved here, we lucked into at the same time Irv Rabel and Rob Hoskins, who owned quite a few, who would become to own quite a few cabarets in New York, had just purchased. They had moved from Ohio and had just purchased the duplex.
Wow.
And
I forget sometimes that Irv had the duplex. He had Brandy.
Don't Tell Mama.
Don't Tell Mama. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he gave me my start at 88s.
And 88s, right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So we were one of the first that, you know, worked, and they liked us so much. They gave us every Saturday if we could do it.
Yep.
So we were performing a lot. And what we do is, because we were making no money,
yeah,
we would go back to Chicago to earn money to come back here to be able to perform.
Yeah.
And that went on for quite a bit. And then we started, in 83, I did get an agent. Somebody had come to see us down at the duplex.
Yeah.
And said, do you have anybody representing you for theater? And it was like, well, no, I don't. And they said, we'd love to. So that they were my first agents I was with for quite a long time.
Wow.
I started doing theater. I got my first job here, actually, to go back to Wichita, Kansas and do Funny Girl.
Right.
And I've always said it's, you know, like here's a Midwestern middle child Catholic going to Wichita, Kansas to play a Brooklyn Jewish girl. They didn't know the difference.
Yeah. There you go. It's called acting.
Yes. So, but then I got my first Broadway show, which was a show called Play Me a Country Song in 84.
Yeah.
At that time, also, Irv bought Don't Tell Mama, the legendary cabaret here in New York, and asked if we would open it. So Nancy Lamott and I were the two opening acts. We switched. So we were done in tandem. So it was Nancy would get the 8, I'd get the 10:30, and this went on for a couple of weeks, but we would switch. So I would get some 8 o'clocks and she would get some 10:30s.
Was Chris Marlowe always playing for her? Was he her guy? Do you remember? I can't.
Chris Marlowe, I think, you know what, honestly, I think at the time she opened, it was Rick Jensen.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah.
And then I think Chris Marlowe came in after that.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. This is a little bit of cabaret history. What's really striking me about all this is that you were actually a cabaret singer first.
Yeah.
I mean, when you think about it, and it's usually people who are tremendously successful in cabaret usually have theater careers and then do it for a lark or a one-off, love it, and then keep doing it. But
right.
You really started in cabaret.
Yeah. And it actually, it was more difficult, and in some ways it helped me when I was covering the role of Norma Desmond in Sunset Boulevard. Being a cabaret junkie was really helped me, because you don't get, as a cover, as the standby, I didn't get rehearsal the same way. I didn't get previews.
Yeah.
You know, it was basically wear this outfit you're on. And, you know, you'll be on in a half an hour. So
it's and you went on a lot. I mean,
I did over a period of maybe 2.5-3 years. I went on 250 times.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I thought you went on a lot. I mean, you played that role.
Yeah, which was great. I covered Glenn Close, Betty Buckley, and Elaine Page, all three of them.
Wow.
And
then
finally left because I got, what happened was I got offered to go with the New York Pops to Japan.
Yeah.
And I thought,
why wouldn't you? Yeah.
I'm going, bye.
Yeah, exactly. Time to move on. Well, let's talk a little bit about cabaret, because I think there are many people, our students that are watching especially, that are confused about what it is. I mean, they, as far as they're concerned, it's a musical by Kander and Ebb if they do their, if they do their research. And I always say that cabaret is somebody basically curating their own experience, some sort of, whether it's just sets. I mean, Peggy Lee, Sharon McKnight said this and it really stuck with me. Peggy Lee didn't say Peggy Lee in When I First Moved to New York. It was just Peggy Lee singing a concert.
Right.
Cabaret is slightly different. It doesn't have to have a theme, but there has to be some kind of a process. I do not like the word journey. I get, when people thank you for thank you for taking this journey with me. I was like, I wanted to sit and drink my two drinks and hear some good music.
Yeah.
But there is a process that you go through and a message that you're giving, and everything from the arrangements, which if you're singing in a musical theater production, you don't have a damn thing to do with the arranging.
Right.
You know? But in Cabaret, this collaboration between you and Chris, which has been how many years?
We just celebrated our 30th anniversary of working together.
Wow. Yeah. So this is Christopher Denny, who is just magic at the keys and a great arranger and a great guy.
Yeah.
And that's what this show, 30 and counting, at 54 Below on November 1st and 2nd at 7 o'clock is about, right?
Right, about right, right.
Collaboration.
The anniversary was August 5th. August 5th. We had our first job together at the Russian Tea Room.
Right.
When they were doing performances, and Brian was very sick at the time and couldn't play, and I needed somebody to play. And we had just done a thing called, do you remember Hearts and Voices? Were you around for that?
I remember hearing about Hearts and Voices. I wasn't in the city when that was happening, but I know about it.
Yeah, it's too bad it doesn't happen anymore, because it was really a spectacular thing. We would go into the do a little show in the hospitals for the AIDS patients.
Yeah.
It was during that, you know, during when it was first starting and also continuing for way too long.
Yeah.
And you know, it would be like a half an hour show with three singers and a pianist, and you got to, you know, help people who are there with their families. Mm-hmm. Just get away from it for a bit. And some of the patients would come in if they could, or you'd go to their room and sing something. It was really a very special thing. And Chris had asked me, he had seen me do a presentation of a theatrical piece that Brian had written for me. And he came backstage and said, would you consider doing this? I was like, yeah, that sounds great. I'd love to do that. I'd love to do it. And so we did it. And I thought, he's really a great player and could play Brian's stuff really well. And Brian respected him, and that was important to me. So when Brian couldn't make it, I asked Chris if he would do it, and he learned it like that. And, you know, over the years, we have a 30 years is a long time.
It's a long collaboration. Now, are you hearing an echo from me?
No, I'm not.
Good. I'm not either anymore. I was for a second. I was going to pop you out and pop you back in, but I'm not getting it anymore. Good. I want to touch on that just a little bit, only because I think for our generation, particularly performers in New York, the pre-retroviral AIDS time mm-hmm. was so poignant and so painful and took so many people from us. I was living in Provincetown, Massachusetts.
Oh,
singing with,
wow.
Working with Richard Weinstock. It was my fledgling in my 20s, and watching boys die at a rate that was so horrifying.
Oh yeah.
And Richard died, and everybody that worked at his, and the three performers that came up that summer were Jay Rogers, Ann Hampton Callaway, and Sharon McKnight.
Oh.
And I know. It was an incredibly poignant summer, but there was no hope in sight. And Reagan didn't even say the word AIDS until 1987. When did Brian die?
He died in 92. So he died
just prior to the antiretrovirals coming out.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, that they had that, they were kind of getting that cocktail thing. It was.
Itch. Yeah.
Yeah. And he just didn't want to do it.
He didn't.
No, he made, I think, listen, wasn't my decision.
Right,
but,
exactly. Yeah.
Dick Gallagher and he got diagnosed at the same time. Brian got, and Dick Gallagher lasted. He was another pianist.
A long time. Oh, I love Dickie Gallagher.
And he lasted for like 20 years past that, 25 years past that. So, you know, Brian made a decision and he went very fast. He was diagnosed in 90, like January 1st of 1990. And died in November of 92. So he went pretty quickly.
Yeah, that must have been unbelievably painful. And
painful and I didn't know what to do with myself. I had been part of two people working together, and now I was just me by myself, and I didn't quite know what to do. And in, we all carry on, if we can.
You have two choices, exactly. But you carry it with you. It's always and a big part of your performance, because I remember you talking about Brian in the Adirondacks when we did the retreat at Heron's Landing. And then you sang a song that he had written, and everybody there was, we were all a puddle, because you could see it. Those are the kinds of experiences that shape your life and shape your music. And and my other thought was that AZT had been an absolute catastrophic thing that they first came out with, and it was actually killing a lot of these guys faster.
That was the one that he
He probably was like, nope, because nobody really knew what these cocktails were, and it was a crapshoot and it was a gamble, and I have no idea how I would respond if I was offered after that terrible debacle of AZT. So
yeah, he tried so many crazy things because he thought, I'll just go holistic.
Yes.
And, it was a lot of protein, massive amounts of vitamin C. My favorite, though, was mistletoe.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. And, so he was just trying everything. And poor baby, it just didn't work.
And it was a time that informed anybody who is over 50, I would say. It really informed who we are. If we were living in any major city or any place like Provincetown, which is a gay town. So. But
you'd go into the bars, you'd go into work at Don't Tell Mama or, any of those places. And the next day, people wouldn't be there. They died.
Yeah, it was devastating.
Yeah, it was hard.
Yeah, because the smallest little thing could kill somebody. Something that would be a cold for me and you would be the end for somebody else. Anyway, I do not mean to be Debbie Downer. I just know that was
not a Debbie Downer. It's something we lived through and made us stronger.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And it was so significant for so many of us.
Yeah.
And I don't want people to forget. I don't want these kids to forget and think that it's a chronic thing that you can just live with. It's very, very serious. And it happened. And, I think it's very important for people to remember upon whose shoulders you are standing. So if you have certain rights, if you have gay rights, the right to get married, there are people that fought for that stuff.
Wow. To get married. I mean, how many of our friends have said, I never thought I'd be able to get married. I mean, people in their 70s.
The only time I was ever married. Yeah, exactly. Right. So,
Oh my God.
It was very significant. All right. So one of the things I would like to discuss about Cabaret, because I think you are particularly good at it, is the arranging process. And I'm actually going to let people hear it and see it also, that only in Cabaret is a person able to take a song that was written perhaps for another gender and play it as an up-tempo and sing it as a ballad. You can do whatever you want to get your message across. You just have to do it convincingly. I've seen good ones and I have seen bad ones. And this is an example of a really, really good one.
There's something new any day, I will know right away, soon as it shows. It may come cannonballing down from the sky, gleam in its eye. As a rose, who knows? It's only just out of reach, down the block on a beach, under a tree. I've got a feeling there's a miracle thing gonna come true, coming. To me, could it be? Yes, it could. Something's coming, something good. If I can wait, something's coming. I don't know what it is, but it is gonna be great. With a click, with a shock, catch the moon. One-handed catch around the corner, or whistling down the river. Come on, deliver to me.
I cut it off right at a time when people want more. I love that show. I remember seeing that show and just loving it, because I think you've reached a place where you can take a song and make it yours, and it's wonderful. Hello, there's the hubby. There's wonderful songwriter, producer, Paul Roldan. Hi, darling. How are you?
Just talk.
Oh, this is a microphone. Wait. Mic test checking. 1, 2.
Yeah, he's a real technological genius, this guy.
Isn't he?
Very true. Yeah. Well, I'm glad to see your face, and we're gonna see something that you produced and made absolutely beautiful at the end of this show. So I can't wait.
And wrote.
Okay. I mean, come on. How about that?
Sounds good to me.
All right. It sounds good to me, too. And I'm
you
glad
look
to
like
see
a little old couple.
You
a
look adorable. The hair color matches, which I love. I love that.
Yeah. She copied me.
I did.
Yeah, there you go. Well,
I just didn't care.
It's the most sincere form of flattery.
I guess.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Paul Roelnick.
Well, it's lovely to see you.
You too,
and
darling.
Now I will do the appropriate thing, which is
go.
Leave.
All right, darling. Great to see your face.
Take care.
You
too. Now get out.
Yeah. Lovely to see you. Now get out. There are going to be some questions from our students, which I have written down. And one of them is, do you study voice?
Oh, yes. I do. I do. In fact, I started kind of late in life. I know a lot of people study when they're younger. Mm-hmm. I worked with a couple, but never really anything that was great for me.
Yeah.
Until 1985, I started really studying. I had some vocal issues. I had what was called a paralyzed vocal cord.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Which was, they said it was like Bell's palsy, you know, where the face just stops. And my left cord stopped.
Wow.
And when I got it back, I thought, I can't waste time. I need somebody to kind of guide me through this. This might be an opportunity.
Yeah.
And so, and, you know, I've just continued that. Yes. You know, sometimes it's easier when you're in town to go consistently.
Yeah.
But I have three people now that I go to for different things.
Yeah.
And it's, I rely upon it very much, because your voice, you know, as your body changes, your voice changes how you produce it. Yeah.
Yeah, and true.
It's good to have eyes to, you know, and ears to tell
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. Always. Always. It amazes me that there are people that get up on stage without a director in Cabaret. I always think to myself, it's, you got to have some eyes on your, you know, on
somebody
your-
guiding you. Because, you know, it's an unknown commodity. And I don't think anyone is that great a judge at what they're delivering.
I completely agree. And, you know, as I've said before, I wrote an entire show called The Fine Wine Off the Vine, because my backup singers were called The Fine Wine. And they happen to be these brilliant ladies who sing beautifully. And a redhead, a blonde, and a brunette. It was hilarious that it's like I couldn't have. And I wrote a whole show for them. I wrote the songs. I wrote out their specific experiences. And it was great. But I didn't have a director. And I called Scott Coulter. And I said, Scott, come look at this. And he said, I love this show. Your opening number is your closing number. Your closing number is your opening number. And it's perfect. And he was so right.
Yeah.
But, oh, my God. Why didn't I think of that? He was so right.
Yeah.
You know, so it's good to have other eyes on it. So
absolutely.
Yeah. Do you have a pet?
I don't right now. I wish I did. because I grew up with cats and I love cats. Mm-hmm. I have a neighbor who has a cat and I go over every once in a while now and just get my cat time.
Yeah.
But Paul, my husband, is really allergic. So, and he didn't have pets when he grew up.
Right.
So he's not... He's a little over. Yeah, I think he thinks it's going to be some, you know, huge change, and it will be. But so he's a little gun shy of getting a pet. And I'm, you know, listen, I'm still working on it because I would love to get, if not a cat, you know, some
allergenic pooch. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. No, I agree.
I think he would benefit from it.
Yeah. Well, it'd end up being his. Completely.
Exactly. You know,
that's what happens. The person says, I don't want a pet. They're dirty. They're too much work. They end up being like, oh, you know. Is there anything in your career that you would do differently? Sort of words of advice for our kids.
Actually, yes. It's not a regret, but it's something I would do differently. And that would be a little bit more business minded earlier.
Yes.
Yeah. I did not really get my stuff together until I was much older, and a lot of time had gone by, you know, and I think I would try to be a little bit, not only more business minded, more assertive about what I wanted.
Yeah.
You know, trying to get that as opposed to just waiting for stuff to fall in my path.
Yes.
And I think I'd also be, I would wish for the younger me to be a little bit more, have a little bit more self-confidence about who I am. It took me until I was about 60 to be able to say, you know, I'm pretty good at what I do.
Listen, it's people, all people, but particularly women in the arts, knowing our worth. And knowing and understanding money, understanding how it works, those things are all intertwined. And having the confidence to say, no, this is what it costs,
right?
And this is what I'm worth. And it's an interesting thing. And also knowing something about your finances in terms of where to put them, what to save for, how to, you know, we don't have a lot of mentoring in that area.
No.
Yeah. It's very important, and we used to get, don't worry your pretty little head about that, honey. I'll take care of all of it. Yeah, exactly. And because we feel insecure about that, we all okay, and we act like, you know. It's, so I hear you, and I think it's great that you got it, you know, that you pulled it together at all, because I think women go through their lives not understanding that it's something they've got to tackle.
Yeah. And, you know, recently I just started working with a manager who, what's so great about it is to be able to say, no, that's not enough. I can't work for that.
Yeah.
Never in my life. I've always felt guilty about it. I thought, what's wrong with me? I should do everything. And I finally got to the point where, wait a minute, those other people are getting what, three times more than I'm getting? Why am I agreeing to less? Because that's I'm a right.
Because if you agree to less, people are going to pay you less. That's how it works.
That's right.
So I hear that. And I think it's just very important. And, you know, one of the things that I say whenever the ASA does any kind of an event where we ask performers to either teach or perform, it's not a lot of money, but we pay. We pay them, because you don't go into a store and say, I sure would like that dress, but I just want to pay $3 for it. That's not how it works. And we've had people, you know, that were quite surprised, you know, that said, oh, a check. And I said, well, you had to get here.
Right.
You get that. And I think that performers need to, what you're selling is something that nobody else can do.
Right.
So in that vein, because I can't believe how quickly this hour has gone
by. Oh, no!
You're fun. In terms of cabaret, do you have any suggestions for people that are interested in being cabaret performers? What would you suggest that they do a lot of?
I would say, you know, and this is just, listen, my opinion, But I think there are so many, the good thing about New York and many large cities is there are ways to, you know, like open mics and piano bars and things like that.
Yes.
To hear the cast party, you know, that is a great thing. And
on, and I'm just about to start an open mic again, which was completely free and people can come work their material.
See this, and that's where you're going to, first of all, you're going to go there, sing, do what, you know, do something you love that you think shows off who you are,
right,
that you absolutely love doing. And then you start meeting people, you meet the musicians, you meet the pianists, get in touch with them and say, could we get together and just sing through some stuff?
Yeah. Get some eyes on you, get some experience.
Then you can get in touch. Then you can start going, you know, if when I start feeling comfortable, getting in touch with Don't Tell Mama. Some of the, you know, Don't Tell Mama is a great start. The Duplex. I don't know. You know, some of these smaller spaces that are more accommodating to neophytes. And learn. Learn. Keep learning. Keep your eyes open. Keep hearing stuff, keep studying. You know, it's not a cheap career, but it is certainly a lot of fun. And there can be many payoffs that are surprises.
I agree. And I think that going to see, for instance, going to see Karen Mason on November 1st or 2nd at 7 p.m. at 54 Below, I think a lot, I think too, that what's happened is that there's a sort of a cabaret community, and it's lovely that they all go and support each other's shows. I think that's great. And I'm not denigrating that at all, but I think setting aside a budget to go see people that are really accomplished and who have really are doing really beautiful work. That is like in the Daryl Henline Award that we're giving now, that is for a career of consistent excellence and distinction.
Yeah.
And a professional career, people that are being paid to do this. And I think that all those things are important. And I think it's important to see people who are doing it like you. So,
yeah. And you know, listen, there's all kinds of, I know 54 Below is expensive, but there are all kinds of, they're always offering on those, you know, the ticket.
Yeah, they have, that's places. Right. Is it GuideStar or there are things like that where
cheaply.
So.
Gold Star.
That's it. I used to be a member, but I don't have time to do that anymore.
Yeah, right. I know.
Yeah.
And so, but they're always offering. You know, I think Theater Mania. Sometimes they have reduced ticket prices, and you know, listen, we're all looking for great audiences. Whether you know, well, I don't know whether you paid $50 or whether you paid $10. I don't care.
Right.
There and you're sitting there and, you know, I hope we'll have a good time together.
Yeah. Well, I can't wait. I'm coming.
Well, good.
And I can't wait. It'll be fun. And I learn something every time I see Karen Mason. Karen, thank you for doing this show today.
It was my pleasure. Absolutely.
So much fun. And I am going to say goodbye to you now with all of my thanks and thanking you also for being so supportive of the LGBTQ community always. Your voice has been a soundtrack for so many of the times when the community needs support, but also in its times of great celebration. So thank you for that. Much love to you, and I'll see you in a few days.
Yay!
All right. Bye.
Thank you.
Oh, well, I popped you out mid-sentence. That was rude.
I said, thank you very much. Now you can let me go.
Okay, bye. So I am going to play Karen out with an absolutely beautiful song written by her husband, Paul Rolnick, and this beautiful video. You'll see many members, if you are a member of the cabaret community, in this video. And I thank you for taking the time to spend this hour with us. If you have not become a member, please become a member of the ASA. It's only $65. And as a benefit of membership, you get a year's subscription to Cabaret Scenes magazine. This is our latest with Barbara Streisand on the cover because we have an exclusive covering her remastering and re-release of the 1962 recording Live at the Bonsoir. So very exciting. Tune in for our next Sunday session series. And this is Karen Mason singing It's About Time. Thank you. Thank you.
a sacred dream about us. You and I have waited for so long, walking down the aisle with each other, showing everyone where we belong. And isn't it amazing how it finally came to be? Standing at the altar for all the world to see. It's about a love that is meant to last forever. It's about a life that leaves nothing left behind. It's about all the time we have left together. It's about love. It's about life. And it's about feels like we have waited 20 lifetimes, wishing for this moment to be real. And now we're stepping into the sunlight to celebrate the my life now feels complete. It's about a love that is meant to last forever. It's about a life that leaves nothing left behind. It's about all the time we have left together. About time. And now that we're here, we know that it's right. Our own piece of heaven, our own paradise. It's about a love that is meant to last forever.